walk from here to Portland to see the aircraft take off of Multnomah Hotel. I think that was in 1912. I was always interested in the aircrafts. I wanted to be around them. I wanted to play with them. Oh, when I was going to high school, this piece of ground was always in my mind. It belonged to an uncle of mine, and I bought it and developed it. It was all brush, and the more I watched the aircraft and thought about it, the more I thought there was a possibility of developing something. And in my mind, I was developing the runway from Walker Row clear on down to the creek. That would be about 4,000 feet. We first started here with gliders. Most of them had a wing of about 36 to 40 feet. That was a wingspan. And there was just a little cradle under the wing where the pilot sat.
Ann went out and made arrangements with Charlie Bernard to fly off his hayfield out at Beaverton, Oregon. It was in the late 20s, and we went out there. Charlie had just done his haying. All they used the field for in those days was for hay and agricultural purposes.
We first started here with gliders. We would take the automobile, and that would get them up. Well, finally, the wintertime ground got wet, and then I had a saddle horse. I'd take my saddle horse and hook the shock cord onto the horn, and I would get them up that way. But most of them were satisfied just to get in the air. They'd fly 100 feet, that's fine. If they fly 1,000 feet, that's just still better. I went out and looked at some of these fields out of Vancouver where these amateurs were trying to fly in the Rose City, I think it was the Rose City racetrack. They were trying to fly there, and they didn't get any cooperation. So one of the Yates was building an aircraft in Beaverton. And I had a little talk with him, and he came out and looked at the field, and he thought it'd be ideal. So I put up one hangar, and I made a runway here for him. And before that aircraft was completed in the hangar down here, I had started four or five more hangars. They were all for homemade aircrafts, the boy's own design. And his first aircraft was finished. It flew and behaved very well. And the next one flew, and then the amateurs started to come in here, and I just kept on building and building. And within a year, I had about 8 or 10 hangars, and they were all homemade built aircrafts.
Charlie was a gentleman, and he became a champion of the flying community, and he fostered it. And I never heard him ever say anything bad about anybody. He didn't fly himself, but he just became a champion for the fellows to have their airplanes. They couldn't be over in Swan Island with the unlicensed aircraft, and he established the field, and he was their champion. So, you know, all the hangars were built out of used lumber and pole construction, and they were pretty crude, but they served their purpose. And, you know, there was a lot of them out there.
I'll tell you, I built the first hangar. It took 2 or 3 weeks to put the first hangar up. And before I got the first hangar up, I had an order for the next hangar. I had smoothed the field out a little bit. And I had an order for the next one. Before I got this one started, I had an order for this one. See, I was building good hangars because the people I built for could afford to pay for them. And all the rest of them, I bought a lot of Foster Kaiser signs, the 4x8 signs that they used. And I built the hangars, the side of the hangars, out of those signs. Of course, I put a metal roof on them. And that's why I was charging these fellows up here, these three along here, $15 a month hangar rent. And the kids that had a hard time getting going, they'd help me build a hangar and so forth. I charged them $5 a month.
I apparently just drove over to see what was going on. And I saw all these airplanes and all the guys around and all the spectators, you know, on a Sunday that was a regular, like you might say, a tourist attraction. It really was something. There'd be cars lined up there. People just come out the airport to watch the fellas fly.
The field in the rougher parts of the year, the rainy season and stuff, usually got down to where you had maybe 700 foot of runway at the best, with some walloping good mud holes that you learn how to skim through. And it usually led to some pretty treacherous takeoffs. We didn't usually run true to the runway a lot of times. We angled. And this, coupled with the crosswind, produced some interesting takeoffs at times. A statement that often was heard around the Northwest: if you were a Beaverton pilot or you could fly and land in and out of Beaverton, you could go anywhere with no difficulty.